Friday, brethren. Still on, yes?
Yes.
Pastor Johnson is a brethren of ours. Pastor Johnson is our district superintendent. So he is a big representative of us. And I want to take the opportunity this morning on the behalf of the Purple Group, Purple Lights, to welcome him as a part of our family. So this is not only the last. Grand Pastor Johnson is already, and no other group should touch him. But that is Purple Lights Pastor seconded. Well, Pastor Johnson is always responsible for the Belmont Circle of Churches. And as Grange Hill Circle of Churches. And he comes to us this morning willingly. We just had to call him once, and he said, all right, let me see if you can work it out. And he did, and he was here on time. So let's welcome him for a please, and Lord, as he says his thing, let the Lord speak to your heart, and allow him to make that change that is necessary. Pastor Thomas.
Joy to be here to share in your morning service. I have brought along with me Sister Sadiq, who is somewhere around. She's waiting. She is from the Grange Hill Church. I'm going to invite you to turn your Bible into the book of Philippians, chapter 2. And you will follow us, I read. Shall we stand for the reading? Father. Yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor, and fellow soldier, but your messenger, and he that ministers to my words. For he longed after you all, and was full of heaviness, because that he had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick nigh unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when he see him again, he may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation. Because for the work of Christ he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shall we to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for those you have called to serve in the various areas of ministry of the church. We thank you, Lord, for their sense of call upon their lives. They need always to offer their best to ensure that they make good of your calling upon them. Pray that you bless your word to our hearts today, Lord, and we seek to investigate the life of an important ally of God, and one who has committed himself to your work. Let us, O God, appreciate what you shall say to us, and to allow that which shall be said to influence our lives for a deeper commitment to you. This we ask in your name.
Amen.
Our reflection is on Epaphroditus as a supporter or a comrade in arm to Paul in his execution of the Christian ministry. It is said by Socrates that a community or a state or a city comes into being because no man is enough in himself. Each man is dependent on other men. The auxiliary or secondary ministry of the church is crucial and critical to the success of the church's ministry as it seeks to gain inroad into the community of which it is a part. To the extent that those who are partners in this ministry understand their contribution or the nature and scope of their contribution and seek to give it their best, then the church's ministry will be effective and it will be able to make inroads in terms of its impact within the community. Epaphroditus was one who provided the secondary support for Paul's ministry at Philippi. His name is translated charming or lovely. He was regarded as a bishop of Philippi. History has it. But essentially, Epaphroditus was there with Paul to ensure that the ministry at Philippi was effective and that the church was able to maintain its impact not only on those who were there as members, but to the wider community. Epaphroditus clearly made an impact, not only within the congregation, within the church, but outside of the church. We want to seek to understand the nature of Epaphroditus' contribution, not only to the development of the church, to the well-being of the church, but its impact on the community. There are three phrases that I want to use to describe the impact of Epaphroditus' work within the church and within the community. First of all, he was conscious of his call. He had a clear concept of his ministry. Paul described him as a brother, a fellow worker, and a soldier, and a messenger of the Philippian church. The Greek word that is used in Paul's description of him as a brother demonstrate that Epaphroditus was conscious that he was equally called to a ministry like Paul, and Paul came to appreciate that. He understood that to the extent that Paul was called by God to carry out the ministry, it is in the same way that he himself was God, that he had a contribution to make, and therefore he was conscious of that. To the extent, brothers and sisters, that every one of us who are called by the Lord, because the Bible tells us that Christ went up in his calling of men, and he said, come unto me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. In other words, he is saying, I want to be a partners with me in an enterprise. I want you to become workers, co-laborers with me, as I seek to win the lost, as I seek to bring back those who have been lost into the kingdom of God. Brothers and sisters, the ministry of the church is going to be advanced to the extent that those who are members of the church recognize that they have a call by God, and therefore are prepared to embrace that call. The sense that the Lord has called them to do a task. The sense that the Lord has given them an opportunity to make a contribution to the development and well-being of the church's ministry. saying, brothers and sisters, that the church's ministry can only be advanced, can only reach into the community when those who are members understood that every one of them has a call. If we don't have that sense of God, we won't make a contribution. If we don't have that sense of awareness, that there's a work for us to do equally like as others, then we will sit back and we will make no contribution. Our partners, the role that we play in church will just be mere a coming and participate in worship. There are many of us whose contribution to the church is merely a contribution in worship. Nothing beyond that. We have never made an input to the development of the church's ministry as it seeks to make an impact in the community. Because we have never had a consciousness of the fact that we are God. We have never had a sense of awareness that we too, like others, can make a contribution. That there's an opportunity to make a significant contribution to the well-being and development of the church as it seeks to reach the love of Christ. Epaphroditus was conscious of that call, and Paul recognized it. And that was why Paul said, he is one who is a brother. He's a brother because equally like me, he sensed that the Lord has called him to do a work. Like me, he sent and the Lord has called him to engage in a task of building the kingdom. And I'm saying, however insignificant you may feel, however small in stature you may feel, you have a contribution to make to the development of the church's ministry, to the outreach of the church's ministry, as it seeks to make an impact into the community. You must sense that there is a call upon your life by the Lord to make a contribution. You must sense that, you must be conscious of that. Epaphroditus had that level of consciousness. Therefore, Paul described him as a brother. Not only that he was a brother, but you see him as a fellow worker. That is to say, he had a shared vision of the nature and scope of the ministry, like Paul. They say he was a fellow worker. He had a vision of where we can reach. He had a focus as to where the church can bring its ministry. Brothers and sisters, if this church is going to make inroad into the adjacent community, everyone within the church has to, within him, in this kind of consciousness that look, the focus of the church is to reach this community and all the adjacent communities around. And therefore, what is it that the church needs to do? The church needs to engage in this kind of activity as a means of making sure it realizes its goal. In other words, Paul was saying that to the extent that he had a vision to reach the world for Christ, Epaphroditus shared that vision. The church can't move when someone pulls up and someone pulls up. When there's a kind of tagawa. The church can't move when some people have a vision that the church only be scared and worship and praise the Lord, and some other vision that the church must go out into the community and reach us. We can't make any inroad, we can't make any significant impact. We can't influence the community in that way. Everybody must, our hands must be on board as to what is the church's focus, as to what is the church's mission, as to what is the church's goal. What is it that the church sets out to achieve, and how is it going to be achieved? Everyone within the church must be aware of that. Everyone within the church must be conscious of that. Yes, sir, brothers and sisters. So Paul must say, I have a vision, a goal to reach the lost. I have a spectrum as to to where, how wide and how far we can reach. And Apollos shared that. Pastor can have a vision that we must go into the community. Up here, down here, down here. But some of these are great, I say, no, Pastor. Up there so rough and tough. The violence up there, so we can't go there. So. And so there is disagreement. So Pastor and few also, but others don't go because they don't share Pastor's vision. The same consciousness, the same understanding as to where to bring the ministry of the church. And Pastor is not shared by the members. Paul said Epaphroditus had this same consciousness as to where and the extent that the church can reach. And remember, within the church must have that consciousness. Every member within the church must have a sense of awareness as to how the church and what the church needs to do to make an impact. And therefore, what you do is that you will find everybody on board. Everybody with the enthusiasm, the vigor, and the vitality, the excitement, the joy of putting all hands on board to make a contribution. Because there's a shared vision of the good. There's a shared vision as to what is the nature of the work and how it can be accomplished. If you don't have that in the church can't go nowhere. Because Pastor wants to go somewhere, but all the other people don't share the vision with him. Don't have that same kind of consciousness. Paul said that Epaphroditus was an auxiliary support staff. A comrade in arm, an ally. He was not the spearhead of the task. But despite the fact that he was not the spearheader, he shared the same vision. He had the same consciousness. And he had that same sense of scope as to where the church can reach. There's a brother, a fellow worker, soldier. Paul said he was a fellow soldier. Same understanding as to the discipline that was brought to the work in order for the work to be accomplished was born on the part of Apollos as it was on Paul. The same willingness to face the danger that will arise as a result of his engagement in the task was shared by Apollos as it was shared by Paul. The same willingness to put his life on line was shared by Apollos and Epaphroditus as it was shared by Paul. You can't have Pastor turn up in the community where the gunman and bad man God live. And the other members say, well, boy, we're not going to because of too much danger. Pastor is prepared, and others are prepared to face the danger. But those others are prepared to shield themselves from the danger. They want to remain in their comfort zone because they want to be sheltered and protected from all alike. But yet they want the church to finish to advance. Yet they want the church to reach the community, but they don't want to face the danger that are resultant of their effort to engage the community. They keep away. Paul said Epaphroditus was not prepared to keep away. He was prepared to face the danger as he was prepared to face the danger. Because he had this sense of consciousness of the nature and scope of his ministry. And I'm saying, if the members are going to move, if the members are going to engage, if the members are going to realize how important it is to make a contribution, they have to share the vision and consciousness and understanding of their call as the pastor has. Most brothers and sisters. So, Paul presented Epaphroditus as one who had a sense of consciousness of his call. If we are going to make a contribution to the development and well-being of the church's ministry, we must be conscious of the fact that the Lord has called us to. You can't be, this is brothers and sisters, you cannot be in the church for 5 years and over. But yet you have not yet understood what is your gifts and talent. You have not yet come to realize what contribution you can make to the well-being and development of the church's ministry. After 5 years, after passing through the rudiments of the faith, you may get it, is it? Then you must know, after 5 years, reach a point that you are ready to engage in the battlefield. You are ready to make a contribution because you want to see the church advance its ministry. Yes, it can't be that all the contribution to make this comes Sunday morning and worship, because very often you don't turn up a Bible study at night. Yes, I'm brothers and sisters. You can't be brothers and sisters. It can't be. It has to go beyond that. Apollo Epaphroditus understood, brothers and sisters, the importance of his contribution. Brothers and sisters, let us understand, you know, that this secondary auxiliary ministry that people like Epaphroditus and Apollos and Timothy provided was critical to development and spread of the gospel. You remember, brothers and sisters, that it was in Acts chapter 2. When the problem arises in the church, and the apostles were engaged in the spreading of the word, that they said, look, we don't have time to bring focus and stability to the church. So look among you and choose men full of the Holy Spirit and of wisdom, and put them in charge. I remember, as a result of that, Stephen emerged. I remember, brothers and sisters, how he stoutly defended the gospel to the extent that he was stoned to death. He was stoned to death. At his passing, he said, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. What is it that motivated Stephen to give up his best? What is it that motivated Stephen to put his life on the line? What is it that motivated Stephen to offer the kind of contribution to the ministry that he stood on as one who was prepared and ready to defend the faith? It was his consciousness that he had a call, equally like others. It was his consciousness that the Lord has anointed him to preach the word. The Lord has anointed him to make a significant contribution to the development of the church's ministry. I'm saying, brothers and sisters, that must be the same level of consciousness that bears upon us if we are going to make a contribution. Amen. We talk about Aquila and Priscilla. Remember when Apollos came to Corinth, and it was Aquila had heard him preach who known the ministry of John, and Aquila and Priscilla took him aside as auxiliary workers and expound to him the new gospel. And therefore, Apollos became very effective to the extent that they begin to compete as to who is their pastor at Corinth, whether Paul or Apollos. Apollos became influential because you had two auxiliary persons within the church who had emerged, who had a consciousness of what is the level of contribution they can make, and stood up and saw Apollos as needing their contribution and impact, and they made that impact upon Apollos' life. You must be conscious of the level of contribution you can make in the church. You must come be aware that you have a talent like the others. You may not be bright and brilliant, but you have a contribution to make in your own way, as the Lord has given you the gifts and talents. In your own measure. Therefore, don't be left out. And don't begin to say you have nothing to make till you see a sign. You must come into the main line. You must put yourself in the mainstream and make a contribution. So if the church wants to reach what's high or any adjacent community, you say, I am on board. Because of that level of consciousness, because of that level of awareness, that there's a call upon your life by God too. That you have a contribution to make to the development of the church's ministry too, like all the others who are on spot. and you are going to give it your best shot. You are going to give it your full 100. But Epaphroditus stood out because he had a consciousness of his call. And that was why Paul highlighted that. Saying he was a brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier. And a messenger of the Corinthians, of the Philippians. Secondly, brothers and sisters, he had a sense of care for people. Paul said he longed after them. Longed after them. You read the text. Say, here. Page 30. So, you read first. So, Paul highlighted the fact that Epaphroditus was impacted by a sense of care for the church, that he was unsettled, that he remained with a feeling of wanting to make a contribution. And at all time, he was disturbed by this feeling of wanting to be there, to make his input, to contribute whatever possible to development and well-being of the ministry of Philippi. Therefore, he longed after them, a yearning to be there, a yearning to be on spot, to see about their well-being. He wants to ensure that they develop in their faith. He wants to ensure that there is stability within the church. Don't forget, brothers and sisters, that there were challenges within the church. Paul himself said that there were those who sought to oppose him, preaching out of malice to add affliction to his body. He's in prison. Remember the two fellow workers there, Eudeus and Syntyche. Struggle between the two. They need to focus. There's need for stability. There need to be a sense of purpose within the church. Because when the church is divided, when there's no unity of purpose, things will get out of hand. And the church, over time, will disintegrate in terms of the effectiveness of its ministry. Therefore, the heart of Apollos is to be here to bring about stability, to provide care and for the people in the development of their faith, to ensure that they grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, Epaphroditus had a sense of care for the members, a sense of care for the people. People must feel cared for within the church. Because sometimes many of us display antisocial behavior towards one another. And we don't try to facilitate them and engage them. Let them feel important. Let them develop high self-concept and high self-esteem. Let them feel that though they may not as bright as us, they still are important to the outreach of the church's ministry. Yes, brothers and sisters. So we make all those who may feel insignificant important. So we show them a sense of hospitality. We want them to feel cared for. We want them to feel beloved. We want them to have a sense of value and purpose. Yes, brothers and sisters. Because it is to the extent that the people feel a sense of value. It is to the extent that the people feel a sense of purpose. It is to the extent that the people have an understanding that they are to a God, that they are going to rise and stimulated and excited about making a contribution. If they feel neglected, if they feel excluded, if they feel unimportant, if they feel isolated, then they walk in and they walk out and you don't see it.
Yes,
yes. Yes, brothers and sisters. Yes. They walk in and they walk out and you don't see it. Because they don't feel that they are important to the ministry of this church. I can make a contribution to the ministry of the church. Epaphroditus ensure that everyone feels important within the church. And that's how we move the church's ministry. Because everyone is excited because they feel important. They feel a sense of value. You empower them with self-belief and self-consciousness. You understand? You make them feel that they can be participants in an enterprise of the church as it seeks to reach a community. And everyone feels important. So when they come, they don't feel say the sister who is bright and every Sunday morning they come pulpit to talk as this person important. They feel that they too are important and they too, their time is going to come when they can up here and make a contribution. And with that, when they can be on the street too and leading and directing, because they know that they can make a contribution. My mother was convinced that she could make a contribution in church. She wasn't right, but the only thing she could read was her Bible. Yes. And every Sunday she come from church, she quarried to herself. Say, the pastor never one day asked her to pray. The pastor, and don't forget as a little child growing up. Mother quarried, the pastor never one day asked her to pray in a church. That prayer was important, well, in terms of trying to find words to describe. But that, what I'm saying is that, however insignificant or bright, what you were saying, the point you were making, is that I want to feel I have a contribution to make. I want to feel that there's a place for me to make a contribution. I want to feel that I am regarded as significant in the development of the church's ministry. Yes, brothers and sisters. If Epaphroditus ensure that the people there feel a sense of hospitality, he longed after them. He wanted them to feel dear to him. He wanted them to feel near to him. He wanted them to know that they are partners with him. So he wanted to be there where they are. So Paul said, Epaphroditus longed after them. He had a sense of care. He had a sense of compassion. A deep heartfelt connection. Brothers and sisters, listen. There is nothing as important within the church as when people feel you appreciate and value them.
Yes.
When they feel that they can hug you, engage you, interact with you, rock with you, they feel important, you know. Though they may not as significant as you are in terms of being in your position. But they feel important because you make them feel important.
Yeah.
It's what you do to them.
Yeah.
It's how you empower them. Give them that feeling. Yes, brothers and sisters. Yeah, man. You empower them by making them feel important.
Yes.
You understand? So when you are out there, they want to be on spot with you. Say, so call the pastor, where you there? Pastor, wait, me a come. You ain't spot yet? Me a come. Then you don't better watch TV. But Pastor, why they on the road? Because they feel important. They don't feel connected with Pastor. They don't feel they're part of Pastor. You understand they're part of the auxiliary leaders. Yes, and brothers and sisters. Yeah, man, they must feel connected.
Yes.
You understand? I prefer that I just feel connected with them. So he longed after them, Paul said. He feel that he was a part and parcel of their life experience. He must feel that God's exercise. If you're going to see them making contribution, they must feel that they are part of the enterprise.
Amen.
You understand? Part of this development of the ministry. Tell the brothers and sisters. He had a commitment to the call. A commitment of faithfulness to the call. So, Paul said that Epaphroditus put his life on line. I said, blow it, but I want to. Let me just give you a time. I take out the marker. So, as a result, please go to the best. Let me read it fine. Verse 30. Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. Paul was a messenger of the Philippian church. It was difficult for them to find another person like Epaphroditus to send to Paul. To the extent that Paul sends that he in the very detractors that are in the church would criticize him for his neglect of Paul in coming back. So he said, I send you the more carefully. Paul said, I sit down and I think about it carefully. Of the importance of Epaphroditus staying with me to provide the support that I need here, being in prison. But I know he would be of greater value to you. So I send him to you. Please receive him and hold him, esteem him highly. Give a sacred kind of approach to his calling to you. Regard him in a solemn way as God sent one to you. Esteem him highly. Hold him in high reputation. Because, let me tell you something, he has put his life on line to ensure that the ministry of the church is carried out. What do you think? There are those who make such pastors who make such significant impact on the church's ministry because they have the sense of call. Why do you think there are those auxiliary leaders who have made significant impact in the church's ministry are regarded as unsung heroes of the church and are extolled and exalted for their contribution to the development of the church? Because they have a sense of their own call. They were conscious of the importance of being committed to their God. So they know that since they are called to this ministry, they are going to give it their best shot. That it can be a wishy-washy effort if they are going to make significant impact. That it can be less than their very best. That the level of contribution that they make to the development of the ministry must be their very best and nothing less. It can be a half-hearted effort. That if they're not in it to give up their best, then they must walk away and leave it alone. That since they decided to take it on, they must prepare to give it their 100. Epaphroditus was prepared to give it his 100. So he put his life on line. In other words, God, when I bow, I go time. But Epaphroditus decides he might have a great ministry here. God is going to back. You understand? Because the last must be reached. There are challenges, there are the adversaries there in Philippi. But Epaphroditus was prepared to take them on. You understand? Somebody wrote about the Philippian church being a persecuted church because of the challenges of those who were there. Not only were they opposing Paul, but he suggests, didn't he like the idea of Epaphroditus coming back? You understand? And that he deduced from Paul's careful seeking to persuade the Philippian church to receive him as an indication that there were those who were opposed to his ministry and had held at one time the church to ransom. Epaphroditus, brothers and sisters, was prepared to give it his 100. He was prepared to be committed to the task. And I'm saying, since you are in it, give it your 100. Since you are engaged in it, give it your best shot. Don't make it a half-hearted effort if you are going to engage. Give it your full 100. Put your life on line for the sake of Christ. You know the words that I use?
One of the words, describe.
I was used to describe Christ's crucifixion, or the presentation of his life was an offering on our behalf. Now say, unless you are prepared to give it your best shot, to put your life online for the spreading of gospel, for the sake of Christ, as a means of winning others, then, brothers and sisters, less than your very best would not be good enough. What you offer must be your excellent very best. It must be your wholehearted effort. Nothing less than a wholehearted commitment to ensure that you fulfill the task, that you accomplish your goal, that you seek to realize that which you set out to achieve, will be able to make an impact, an inroad into the community that you are going to be able to reach. Epaphroditus is a model for us. One who was very conscious of his call. He sensed that the Lord has called him like anybody else. He never feel any less than those who are high up there. He felt that though he may have been small up down there, equally like Paul, he has a sense that he had the Lord has called him, and therefore was prepared to give his own to you. You must be conscious that the Lord has called him. You must be aware of the fact that now that you are saved and in the church, there's a ministry for you to contribute to. You can make a contribution to the well-being and development of the church. If you are going to make an impact on the lives of people, you must have a sense of hospitality, a sense of care. You must be caring. You understand? Can't be a kind of exclusive, that kind of antisocial kind of attitude. You know those attitudes that push people away from you? Yes, I must get an attitude that attracts people to you. You understand? That compels people to want to be there with you and for you as you carry out the task. That must be the kind of attitude. Sense of a caring attitude. Because if you're going to just lie, you have to be caring. Then there must be commitment. When you are once you are called and engaged, give it your full 100. Give it your best shot. Because for the task to be accomplished, it has to be your full 100. May the Lord help us to be good and faithful stewards, to be those that are committed to the task. Because every one of us are called. Every one of us has a ministry. And the Lord is depending on us to fulfill it. May the Lord bless his word unto our hearts for his name's sake.
Yeah.